Thank you, ma'am. Starting with our very first session, a fireside chat with the topic Bridging the Gap. We would like to highlight the importance of connecting all stakeholders, helping bridge the gap between the have and have-nots, and plugging the holes through knowledge sharing so we can build a better responsible future. May I invite our Mr. Richard Rekhy, former CEO KPMG and present board member KPMG Dubai. With over 30 years of his experience, Mr. Rekhy is admired for his clinical approach towards the corporate governance, enterprise risk management, internal controls, and business processes across multiple domains. To join him on stage, may I invite Ms. Ruby Ahluwalia, founder and managing trustee of Sanjeevani, Life Beyond Cancer, an IRAS officer. She is also the principal financial officer of Southwestern Railways. A cancer victim herself, she is the force behind Sanjeevani, with counseling centers in 11 cities, all manned by rehabilitated cancer survivors.
Good morning, everybody, and Suparna, congratulations. I can't see you, maybe the lights. Congratulations for having the guts to put something up is not easy to start, and I think this will go a long way, because when I was thinking on this, I was wondering is that how do you actually use platforms like SABERA to spread the good work that is being done by number of people across the country. It's only when we travel do we realize what work is getting done out there, and somebody has to talk about it. And there are platforms which speak, but we have to keep speaking about it, not once, twice, or maybe 100, 200 times, or whatever. So basically, we are going to talk. We are going to hear the story of Sanjeevani here. We are going to hear what has been done, and how Ruby Ahluwalia has actually taken it there. But just before we get into the most exciting part of the talk, I would just like to share a few of my thoughts around this. Personally, for me, this journey began in 92 when I started giving back to society. It was a personal moment in life, a personal low in my life, which I went through. And that actually motivated me to find something through a medium of helping others. And I think that was the most biggest healing process that one went through in life. And for me, I have been a great advocate of something what I called higher purpose. I always say we all have a job, we all earn money. That is my current account. What is my capital account? My capital account is my higher purpose. And those people on the share market and who invest will know that the capital is more valuable than the current. And how do you actually enhance that capital account from time to time? So I'm a great advocate of higher purpose, of what we do beyond our job. And this is a platform which will come and tell you there is lots that you can do. And you know, we were discussing between ourselves and at various forums where I've discussed is that there is such a big gap to be bridged between the haves and the have-nots. It's too big. And we can't expect either the government or the corporates or individuals or whatever to come, I think, or NGOs for that matter. I mean, this entire set of people need to come together to make that impact. And not to be in conflict with each other, because what we are seeing many times is a conflict taking place, which is completely. And I completely agree with you, Suparna, when CSR was launched. In fact, INSEAD, which is a university in France, they approached me and they said, would KPMG sponsor? They wanted to study this 2%, what impact it has on society. They wanted to understand how is it going to do it, but they were charging too much money, so we abandoned that project. But the point is that the world wants to understand what has this 2% done. because the first time anywhere in the world has a government kind of mandated, in my view it is mandated, 2% for corporates to put in. There's a large amount of money which went in. NGOs were not ready, the processes were not there, and all that we can hear about it as we go along. But, and also I would like to leave one last word with everybody before we hear the other story, is the spirit of stewardship. This is something that has been with me in my entire corporate life. Spirit of stewardship is means I'm holding something in trust to give it back to the next generation better than what I got it. And I think that's what we need to ask ourselves. What are we giving back to the future generation? What are we teaching them? Are we inculcating a sense of giving back to society? You know, we spoke about this political school. You know, I'd gone there and I was completely blown. Let me tell you, when I went there, I was completely blown by what I saw. And what Mr. Swami told me was that the students who study there, after they clear and they get their jobs, they contribute back to that school. That is the spirit of giving that you want to bring into every Indian, into everybody which is there. And you know, whatever it is about giving back. It is not about the lakhs of checks you write, but it's that spirit which we need to build into all of India. Because I believe that if each of us in this country, and we keep hearing this figure of 200, 250 million middle class people adopt 5 people, we would have solved India's problem. But I think that is something that we need to work on. But we would like to now listen from Ruby on her story as to what prompted her to start Sanjeevani and what was behind, what was the ethos behind what she's doing in Sanjeevani. She's got a great job, but what prompted her to actually go into this and work on this project?
So good morning, all of you wonderful people to be here this morning. And Suparna, thank you so much for creating this platform. And I wish and I pray, Mr. Rekhy just talked about the capital market. So I sincerely pray that you become and your organization becomes the mecca of the spiritual capital market in this country. I really hope so. As far as my story goes, I have been working for donkey years now. I'm from the 86 civil services exam. And in 2009, suddenly I was diagnosed with a stage 3 cancer. So initially you are numb and then you gather your wits. And since I was in Bombay, I went to Tata Hospital. I hope none of you have been to Tata Hospital, and I pray that you don't ever visit that place unless and until you are going there as a provider. So when I went there, you're basically jostling for foot space in that hospital. And you must have just noticed, 15 minutes back, we were all here and we were, I think, not more than 50, 55 people. And there was so much of noise which was there because we were talking to each other, we were trying to get to know each other. But in Tata Hospital, where there are so many people that you are fighting for foot space, it's totally silent. And I went there for my treatment with the director of Tata being, my friend. And I would, of course, go with my visiting card, which works in this country. And I would see that this journey, which is becoming so difficult for me, at least 4 to 5 times I went to the balcony and I thought, is it a good idea to jump? How do the rest of the people who do not have any of the resources that I have, how do they put up with this? Because most of the time they were walking like robots actually in the hospital, of course without the efficiency of a robot, but like in terms of the looks in their eyes. So this look in their eyes where there was total hopelessness, there was total helplessness, was something which prompted me ki mujhe kuch karna chahiye. And I would talk to my doctor while being treated only ki main kuch karungi jaise hi main theek ho jaungi. And my doctor would tell me ki stage 3 mein ho पहले जिंदा बच जाओ उसके बाद कुछ सोचना करने की एंड बाय ग्रेस ऑफ गॉड सो इट टुक मी अराउंड 3 years टू गेट बैक टू माय फीट एंड द डे आई जॉइन माय वर्क एंड आई सैट ऑन माय चेयर इट लुक लाइक इफ आई डोंट डू इट देन who would actually yeah so I've gone through the treatment I have the resources thank god I have been blessed with good education and I've been working so long I know how organizations run so I should do this so I registered Sanjeevani life beyond cancer with this in the background
I've done some research on you. So after you said that I'm going to do a fireside chat with her, and of course I've spoken to you also for the first time, and I truly admire after reading about you and your interviews and other things out there. I mean, it is amazing for a person who has gone through all of this to come and give back. While she's saying yes, who other than me? But I want to know how many people because would actually come back and do what she has done. And so, you know, you are doing so much of work in this area where you are helping people. We were just in the morning discussing that she's now posted in Hubli. So she just cannot keep her hands to herself. So she started something in the Bangalore area. She started something in a few other areas around there, saying, okay, I've got my free time. My family lives in Bombay. So what do I do with my free time? This is what you call giving back. And she's not stopped at where she is, where Sanjeevani. Could you tell us what is it that is driving you? Okay, one was you got this and you said, okay, I must give back to society. What is the ethos behind what you do?
What happened was what I realized when somebody is diagnosed with cancer, your world kind of, you know, rattles. But then there is a picture of God which appears in front of you, which looks like the doctor. And you visit the doctor. And I saw in Tata Hospital, each patient gets max 3 to 4 minutes with the doctor. I mean, damn it, I've been diagnosed with cancer, and I'm coming to the doctor, and I have so many questions, and I get just 3 to 4 minutes with the doctor. So your world crashes when you come out of the consulting room. It had not really crashed when I was told that I had cancer, but the biggest support system that I was looking at has totally disappointed me in terms of time. And it's not their mistake, because there are so many patients, they're trying their best, but they're not able to give more than 3 to 4 minutes. So I wanted to be for them when they come out of the consulting room. So the first project that we started is that we have our people in the OPDs. So you don't have to approach Sanjeevani people. Sanjeevani people approach the patients and they handhold them in the field of the emotional support, the logistic support, navigating them inside the hospital, handling the whole of their family problem, because there are so many women who are deserted by their families when they are diagnosed with cancer. And mind you, we work with underprivileged cancer patients, so we work only in sarkari hospitals as of now. So there are a lot of women who are totally deserted with their small children because they have been diagnosed with cancer. So the first project that I started was the hand-holding project. I was very sure that the hand-holding has to be done by somebody who has gone through the experience themselves, because their empathy is different. And I also wanted to rehabilitate these people who will become the resource people, because I didn't want to get somebody from a different background who comes to do social work as a feel-good factor. I wanted to pick up people from the same background and train them and put them in the OPD. So I approached the director of Tata Institute of Social Sciences to ask if they have a course where I can train these cancer survivors. He told me not only us, but there is no course in any academic institute in the world where there is a course like this to train cancer survivors to become cancer caregivers. And he said, but if you are ready to write the curriculum, we will, you know, get it passed by the academic committee. So I took 4 months leave and I wrote this curriculum, which now runs as a full-time 5-month training program to train cancer survivors to become cancer caregivers. The idea was to keep the wisdom that they have gained through their experience in the world of cancer only. I didn't see much point in training them to weave baskets. That may have its own, pros, I'm sure. But I wanted to keep their wisdom in the cancer world itself. And that is how our second project started, which is the training program. And one day when I was doing research on, I was looking at the net on cancer, I realized that cancer cells are present in everybody. If cancer cells are present in everybody, then what happens in certain bodies that cancer happens? And this is what set me thinking. Another thing, cancer is a disease which generates from inside. So it's not like that I have, you know, got it from somewhere. So if it has generated from inside, then it needs to be dealt with also from inside. The medicines can help, but it needs to be dealt with from here. So we started our third program, which is the wellness program, where we've got amazing results, where we work on the immunity of the cancer patients, where we teach them those life skills where they can improve their immunity and fight with the cancer cells on their own. So our third program got started. And one day in Tata Hospital, I was there waiting for the doctor, and there was a lady who came out and she started crying pretty badly. I said, what happened? She said, wo doctor ne bola abhi chemotherapy hogi. So I said, haan, to itni pareshan hone ki baat nahi hai. She said, nahi, lekin usme hoga kya? She didn't even know ki chemotherapy mein, what exactly will she go through? Is it some kind of an operation? It is some kind of a, medicine? What bird is that chemotherapy? She didn't know. So we started this fourth program where we make documentaries on the whole process of treatment. And so if you visit our YouTube channel, we have some 72 films there, which are either educational or motivational. Most of them have been shot in the hospital, and the doctors have spoken just for the patient to know when the doctor says that radiation will happen, what exactly will happen to me and my body. So that is how the fourth program started.
I think that is great, and I'm sure a lot of us, Meeta, you would have picked up education, starting a new curriculum. It's always a challenge in this country where we are talking of we need to skill people and get it. It's great that you have got it. And I think maybe the idea which I'm getting from here, why can't we do it for other similar terminal kind of diseases other than cancer where people go through? Because I just share one small incident which I was sharing with you in the morning. A very, very close friend of mine, who used to work with me in Arthur Anderson when I was there. He was in India, posted here from his company, and he was going on a holiday. Tickets planned, that evening he was flying out, and just for some reason he got some tests done on him and his kids, found his daughter had cancer, leukemia. First stage cancer. He cancelled his tickets, flew to London, and he was talking exactly what she was saying, the kind of the way they treated. He's saying it's the treatment could have been the same in India, I'm not saying. But the kind of the way they explained to the girl, the family, the counseling they went through, it was an experience, it was a life-changing experience for the full family. They are a different family from before the disease. His daughter, fortunately, is completely cured today. 9-year-old girl going through this, and the way those doctors, nurses actually explained to her what she's going to go through and what she's going to experience. She's going to have loss of hair, she's going to have all this. Everything was told to her, nothing hidden. Everything was told to her and told her, don't worry, everything will come back, but that's what you go through. I think this is what we need to bring into our country. I think we need to bring that empathy factor. We need to bring that we're dealing with human beings, we're dealing with people who need love and affection, and I think that's something that awards like these, the heroes, what Suparna was saying, who you're going to see later during the day, these heroes will motivate us to actually get off our chair. You know, my biggest personal experience in KPMG when I was the CEO of the firm was not running the firm. My biggest, I think, achievement, what I feel, was running Enactus in India, which is an organization, which is a global organization, which gets students to actually get into entrepreneurship projects, helping the less fortunate. And the crowning glory was when the team from India went onto the global stage and won the World Cup, you know, that for the project that they had done. And because these are, and you know, people used to come, CEOs, very people, we managed to invite them and used to go and tell them, thank you very much for coming and being on my jury, coming and being on the judge, because we used to get about 100 to 150 CEOs to come for those 2 days to judge the competition, because there were so many university students who were there. They saying, why are you thanking me? I want to thank you for giving me this opportunity, for coming here. And somebody had tears in his eyes, you know, the way this to watch these projects. It was the most, it was a great life-changing moment. It was, for me personally, a greatest achievement to be on the chairman of for the India firm and also to be on the global board of Enactus. It was, it's a wonderful organization helping students from a very young age become entrepreneurs, started for a very different purpose by Sam Walton of Walmart to get students trained so he didn't need to spend money on their training, but it actually took a very different turn and it's become something which is really fantastic and going. So, you know, you have been in this field, you have been in this area. We go as givers or whatever from our side, but you've actually worked here. What would you say is the state of philanthropy in India? How would you see the state of philanthropy in India?
State of philanthropy is pretty sad, actually, if you ask me. In fact, I have now been working in this field for 6 years, and initially it was extremely difficult, although I don't give money to patients, so my projects don't need that kind of money. I have very good monitoring systems in place, and for my first project, I did not go out to ask for money from anybody because I wanted to create a body of work that I can showcase. But despite that, individuals whom you think can give money find it very difficult to part with this money. And the corporates which are there, despite the fact that the CSR has come, they make you feel like beggars for some reason. They don't make you feel that you are doing some work, you know, which the society should be doing. So that is the kind of feeling I get as far as the philanthropy is concerned. And most of the time what the individuals do, they will tell you, "Are India mein to bahut hi bekar NGOs hain. One is never sure kya kaam ho raha hai, kya kaam nahi ho raha hai." So I'm not very sure. You know, this kind of a thing, which is the most irritating. Because, see, when you go and approach somebody, you're not only asking for money. You are asking for time, you are asking for their expertise. And I think the answer lies in active volunteerism. Pehle aap aao, dekho, samjho, you work for a month, give 1 hour a week only. Whether it is the corporates or it is the individuals, come, see my work, experience, talk to the beneficiaries, spend a little bit of time before you give that verdict ki India mein. It's like this, you know, that we say ke aajkal hum log jitna khana kha rahe hain, most of that is adulterated. But that doesn't mean we have stopped eating, have we? We haven't, we look at options which are the healthier options and we eat that. Similarly, I think one needs to work over here.
So, I think maybe what we need, there are going to be different panels and different people coming and discussing here. But I think what we need to take away from here is how do we get people, I would say individuals, and corporates and others who can actually start contributing back to a cause and a need. Because I am a product of this society, and today if I am successful, there are many other people who have actually contributed to it knowingly and unknowingly. And what is my responsibility as a good citizen to give back to that society which has made me what I am? Because I cannot be a single beneficiary. I cannot be so selfish that I don't do it. And I think we need, each of us in our own small way, need to see how we can spread it. You're talking of amplifying it through various social media platforms, which is a fantastic way to do it. But I think the best example anybody can do it by themselves. If you can, you know, today she's appealed, can somebody just come and volunteer? Because I know we are sponsoring the Olympics, KPMG Dubai is sponsoring the Olympics for the Global Olympics for the differently abled people. And the biggest thing people are asking is not for the money, but for volunteers. They are saying, can you come and volunteer to run it? Because they want to run it at a very low cost. And they want corporates to come forward and give hundreds of people to be volunteers into those various events, athletic events that happen. So I think it's time for us to all look and say, how do we as individuals, and you know, what is our responsibility? Do we, every time we are creating waste, every time we are building, the whole point which I see when you talk of philanthropy or CSR, oh, corporates must donate. I think first we should let the corporates make money. And then we should say, okay, now that you have made money and you are healthy, because only a healthy person can help. You see in the plane when you sit there, first put on your own mask, then help the person next to you with a mask. And if you take that philosophy and say that if these guys make money, they should now learn to give back to society and individuals. Why do we have to wait for the other person to give? Just let's do our own bit. I mean, we don't need to wait for the world to come forward, you know. And all of us... I used a simple philosophy, you earn X amount of money, can you take a percentage of it and give it back? Simple. And take that, and I think if you can just do that, I think simple. Life just moves on. Because you have to contribute your bit, you have to go around also helping in so many cases. There's a friend of mine who started this roti bank just outside the Tata Memorial Hospital, where he takes food, leftover food, from whichever these banquets, etc., that happen, and comes and gives food for all those poor people, not the patients, but all the people who come with the patients who are sitting outside. So all the food is given free every day to them. So, I mean, so these are people who selflessly go, and he started with nothing. He started this project. He says, come and help me. If those who want to put money, put it. So he's got a company called Roti Bank, an NGO, which is actually giving food. And there is a research which is carried out. If all the food that we waste, all the food that is wasted or thrown away, if it is given to people who have not got food, they will all turn very healthy. So it will just not meet their requirements. So as a society, we are overproducing. And because we are overproducing, we are creating a lot of waste in the society. And I think that is something that needs to be looked at. So every time we do something which is wasteful, let's think of the person who doesn't get it. I mean, I think these are few things which I will want to leave some thoughts with you. And, you know, as we go into... So, you know, like for when we keep talking of this corporate social responsibility, what happens, most of it? Because we have to contribute 2%. So we come and we tick a box. We tick the box and we said, we have contributed our 2%, we have done what we have to do. What is your responsibility to see that money is being spent in an impactful way that is actually having an impact on different people to which the, where the money is going? I think we need to move from the tick in the box to the spirit. If we get into the spirit and if we truly believe in it, if we truly believe in it and we want to get there, then I think we need, and we need more people like this to actually come forward and become believers that this country needs it. Every time we go outside and we see the poor, see the people who are less fortunate than us, I think our heart should actually beat and say, okay, what can I do as an individual to actually move forward on it? Because if we don't, I think we are going to have a society which is, my view, my personal view, it makes business sense to give back. It makes business sense to give back. Because your business will grow if there are more prosperous people who are less fortunate today. I think we need to move forward. What would you think? You did speak about the good, bad, and the ugly. You didn't say the ugly. I'm adding that word, not from you. But, you know, but every part of society has the good, it has the bad, and it has the ugly. So the NGOs are not the only ones which don't have it. So what is it that can be done to improve the image that has been created by perception? Some of it could be reality. Is there something that the NGOs could do, or people like you are in this field can actually do to change that image in some way?
I feel like we have a public-private partnership now. We should have public, non-profit, private partnership. PNPPP, whatever that means. So what I was meaning to say is we work only in government hospitals. So there has to be a kind of partnership. So the corporate which is giving the CSR funds, the hospital that we are working in, of course, Sanjeevani in this example, and patients' representatives. All of them have to be on the board to see whether the work which is assigned or which the Sanjeevani is mandated to do or the CSR funds are coming for is delivered as efficiently as it can. I think that would bring in a lot of confidence in people. Today we have so many social work colleges. We have NSS in India. All of them have to compulsorily do the field work. Why should not the CSR cells of corporates tie up with these social work colleges? Because what happens right now, a lot of corporates which come to me, they say that our employees would like to volunteer. I'm very happy. But to design a product for them to volunteer for 1 hour in a month is a challenge for me, isn't it? And that also, because this is not people who are doing serious volunteerism. So I think if they take students and interns from these social work colleges, ask them to submit a report to the CSR cell from where they get to know as to what kind of work is happening, and then project the non-profit that they are working with. That will bring in a lot of credibility for the work that the non-profit sector is trying to do. As of now, what is happening is, if somebody has a wound, then there are people who want to heal the wound. There are also people who want to, or who decide to become the maggots in the wound. They basically feed off the wound. And there are third kind of people who are basically standing and looking at the whole process. In India, the people who are looking and standing at the whole process is huge. The people who have decided to become maggots in the wound and feed off it is also pretty huge. The people who are trying to heal is very small. Actually, platforms like SABERA can convert these fence sitters who are standing and looking. So probably that can be done, and it will bring credibility to.
See, so I think the point you made is so valid, that how do we get more people converted? I think the audience which we are talking to is already the converted audience, and I think that's why they are here. We need to go to places where the audience is not converted. And I don't know how we're going to do it. Honestly, I don't have the answer to it. But I think if more heads come together, we'll be able to get an answer of how do we go to people who actually are not what you're talking of, feeding off, who are not actually contributing and converted. The one way which I always think is the best way is to start when children are young. Schools. That's the best place to start. Because when you inculcate into them that sense when they are in school, they will grow up to be those kind of human beings. It's the ecosystem that we're going to create that is going to go there and going to, you know, help these students actually become good citizens as they grow up. Because I saw in 1 year when, not this year, but a a few years back when this whole Diwali thing was going on, and then the schools brought it, took it upon themselves to spread it. It was the children who told the parents, we don't want to fire crackers. It was not the parents, but the children who said it. So I think it starts there. If you want to deal with the malice in this country, it's a malice. Let's understand, it's a malice. We need to deal with it. I think we need to start at the students. We need to put it into their minds that they need to give back. I mean, schools, at the young age, I think education is not about just teaching them to pass exams and become this. How do we bring a more holistic learning into our schools where we actually take them to learn much beyond just studies? How do we make them good human beings? How do we make them great citizens? Because I've always held this view that when we, when you have finished your first part of your career, and when you hang up your boots for your first part of a career, nobody's going to come and ask you which car you drive or how many cars you have or which house you live in or what is your bank balance, because they've got nothing to do with it. They're just going to ask you one question. How many lives have you touched? And if you can answer that question and say, how many lives have I touched while I've lived my life, I think that's something that we should start at. Because if, the always held the view that if tomorrow comes and you're not there, how do you want to be remembered? And if tomorrow comes and you want to be remembered as somebody, I think that is something where we started. If you're not, there is no age to start this. You can start at any age. You can start it when you're 10 years old. You can start it when you're 70 years old. There is no age. If Mr. Swami could start that school at 60, today he's 80. I mean, hats off to a man. At 60, when people feel tired, my bones are cracking, I just don't have the energy, and here's the man goes to set up a school with no money. That is the amazing stories that we will, we'll be hearing so many more today. But these are the people who are the real heroes of this country and who need to be put in on a platform. I used to earlier say, who are the real VIPs? Actually, these are the people who are the real VIPs, and they need to be treated, because they are actually giving their personal time, their personal money, whatever money it is, back to the society in which they were born. So the other big issue we have, Suparna, do we have still time or do we need to get off the stage? Okay, we can do. Okay, one last point which I wanted to ask, and then maybe anybody's got questions can do it. This whole challenge we have around regulations, do you think the regulations around this in this industry are good enough? Or are they obstacles in making you do certain things? Or do you have the freedom to actually operate the way you want?
You're talking CSR regulations? So I don't really believe in the way the regulation has come up. I think to regulate the whole CSR space, there could be CSR bodies, regulatory bodies in each city, in each village, and the members there should be the well-meaning citizens. Not necessarily a bureaucrat has to be there, this thing has to be there. Just those, 20 people in the city who are well-meaning, who have proved their mettle in their field. If we can create bodies like these in each city and each village, where they kind of give a report card kind of a thing to all the non-profits which are working in their area. That would become a very comforting factor for the corporates and the individuals who are putting in the money. I somehow believe that this kind of regulation would yield better results.
We'll now open it up for any questions. Yes, sir. There's a mic coming.
My question, I'm Ashton Sharma, and I congratulate at the outset Mrs. Ahluwalia
for so
wonderful work she is doing under the banner of Sanjeev. No. Lot of questions have been raised regarding the credibility of the NGOs, regarding the regulation of the CSR. Let us not talk about that. There are good NGOs, there are bad NGOs also. Both are existing in our country. Now my question to you is, this cancer then coronary disease, heart disease, then diabetes. These incidents in our country are increasing. I don't know whether you have these statistics available with you. How many persons are suffering with cancer in our country? I don't know the figure. Probably you. No. My question to you is, now, as far as the right of education and right of health is concerned, it is provided in our constitution. Each citizen has the right to access education and as well as health. Unfortunately, after the independence in 70 years, government has not done much as far as health is concerned. This is the least priority of the state government or the central government. Now, one scheme, Ayushman, has been announced about only 3 months back, launched. Under that, 5 crore persons, as claimed by the government, will be covered, where they will get, hospitalization up to 5 lakhs. Now, my question to you is, can you not give this suggestion to the health ministry that there should be some component of that hospitalization cost of medicine fees to give this services, which you are giving hand-holding services at different hospitals, and that is the real thing, beyond treatment, that social this thing, giving consolation to the family, that no, it's not the end of your life, the life is still there. See, as you are talking, I think that will perhaps this is untapped area, and this the NGO like you, who has a very strong will to do, and you have devoted your life, rest of your life for this car. I think if suggestions go, probably government can agree that 10% of that money or 5% of that money. You forget about CSR, if that money comes, you can treat, you can handhold less of persons in our country in the village. This is my.
So, very well said, Mr. Sharma. Actually, the hand-holding project that we did do, we did an impact study of that program through a sample study of 350 patients across the country through a research organization, third-party research organization. While 100% of the patients said that the support which was given to them in terms of hand-holding was necessary, 77% of them said that we could not have continued with the treatment if this support was not available. So with this report that I have now got, I am trying to do a lot of advocacy with the government that all the government hospitals, right now I'm working with cancer, so I'm talking of cancer, that all the government hospitals through which the government schemes in terms of finances are delivered to the patients, there these hand-holding resources should be made mandatory. So I'm doing that advocacy already. I hope that I'm able to get somewhere with it.
So my name is Dev. I'm a co-founder of Voice of Slum. So hum log education pe kaam karte hain. तो मेरा एक हम लोग गरीब बच्चों को गरीब तरीके से मतलब सो मैनी एन जी ओज इन नोएडा मेरे आसपास ही बहुत सारे एन जी ओज हैं जो स्लम्स में जाके बच्चों को पढ़ाते हैं और अगेन कि हफ्ते में 2 दिन वॉलंटियर करने से क्या वो बच्चे प्रॉपर एजुकेशन ले पाएंगे तो आप उस पर नज़रें डालिए कि गरीब बच्चों को स्लम्स में जाके गरीब तरीके से और हम चौक और स्लेट्स पे आज पढ़ा रहे हैं तो वो क्या उनकी जिंदगियां एक्चुअल में बदल पाएंगे या ऐसा कुछ मतलब गरीब बच्चों को गरीब तरीके से और पढ़ाना इस पे क्या
देव प्रताप गरीब बच्चों को गरीब तरीके से आप पढ़ा रहे हो और आप इतने इंस्पायरिंग हो आई थिंक वो ज्यादा महत्व रखता है कि ये नहीं कि स्लेट या चौक के ऊपर क्योंकि आप वहां से उठ के रैग पिकर होके खुद और खुद कितनी कठिनाइयों का सामना आपने किया और फिर आप बच्चों का लाइफ संभालना चाहते हैं आई थिंक चौक और उसका फ़र्क नहीं पड़ता आप जो कर रहे हैं वो इंस्पायर करके कि वो सही रास्ते पे जाएं आपका भी हाथ किसी ने पकड़ा था ना
जी बिल्कुल हम लोग स्लम्स के बाहर स्कूल चलाते हैं तो मैं ये जानना चाहता हूँ कि सो मैनी एन जी ओज जो स्लम्स में पढ़ाते हैं हमारे उन्हीं बच्चों को शाम को आएंगे और वो डिस्ट्रीब्यूट करते हैं खाना और वो सब, तो वो क्या एक्चुअल में वो पढ़ाई या वो कुछ वो इनकी जिंदगियां बदल रहा है या नहीं?
आई थिंक व्हाट हिज क्वेश्चन इज कि जस्ट डूइंग वन थिंग ऑफ एक्ट ऑफ काइंडनेस टू प्लीज योर ओन हार्ट्स, does that make a difference?
So actually this is the he's raised a very good point, and I think he's hit the crux, because the hole is so deep and it's so large, whatever you do gets lost. That's, I mean, indirectly I think it's a matter of attitude, like what you have done to your life. It's a matter of attitude. You know, we have to move from a area in which we live in poverty and scarcity in our mind, when I'm talking of poverty and scarcity, to abundance and generosity. I mean, if we can get that mindset put into people, it's a mindset. It's not about money, having a lot of money. It's about moving in a mindset. And if we can have the attitude that I want to, and you can take even the most educated kid, he can go and be a failure. And you can have the kid who has got this kind of opportunity, still goes and makes it. So it's a matter of attitude. When you see a lot of these people who have come from the from a different, you know, I've seen in my corporate life, so many people have come from the lower middle class and they have rubbed shoulders and become what they have become. So I don't see
may
any
I just,
reason.
Yeah. Sorry for interrupting. Yeah. May I just say something to him? Jo aap kar rahe hain, uska bahut farak pad raha hai. You're looking at the beneficiary, right? उस बच्चे को जैसे कि support group कर रही हैं, उस बच्चे को कोई देखने वाला नहीं है in class. Maybe there's no teacher, maybe there are too many children. And I'm sure you'll agree with me that even that little bit of personal attention they are getting, that little chalk and slate, से उनको बहुत फर्क पड़ रहा है. बच्चे में confidence आ रही है. कल वो school में जाएगा, उसको कुछ तो पता होगा ना. तो बहुत फर्क पड़ रहा है. आप करते रहिए.
यहाँ पर क्वेश्चन शायद मैं समझा नहीं पाया हूँ.
सो
सो मेनी एनजीओस, जो बहुत सारे एनजीओस हैं जिनको काफी बड़े आई हैव सम नेम्स, और वो बच्चों को क्या करते हैं, बच्चों को बिठाते हैं शाम को और उनको पार्क में बिठाएंगे, बातें करेंगे, फ्रूटी देंगे और उनके फोटोज खींचेंगे एंड दे पोस्टेड इन एफबी एंड गो टू सीएसआर. एंड उनको इतना सारा सीएसआर मिल जाता है कि हम सो वो 10-15-20 सेंटर चला रहे हैं उन छोटे केवल नोएडा सेक्टर 45 में. और हम लोग अगर हम जैसे छोटे एनजीओस जो हैं और हम लोग एक अच्छी तरीके से जो मेन स्ट्रीम के बच्चे जैसे पढ़ते हैं उसको पढ़ाने की कोशिश कर रहे हैं, तो नहीं आपके पास तो पहले से सब कुछ, आप तो मतलब टेबल चेयर पर पढ़ा रहे हो, इसमें सीएसआर नहीं मिलता. तो बेसिकली माय क्वेश्चन इज दैट कि क्या गरीब बच्चों को गरीब तरीके से पढ़ाना चाहिए? क्योंकि आज मैं एग्जाम्पल मेरा है कि मेरे पास रिसोर्सेज थे तो मैं आज आगे आपके संग बैठ पा रहा हूं.
तो आप ऐसे करो कि ये जो एनजीओ है, जो एनजीओ है उनको बोलो कि जो पैसा आपको मिल रहा है मेरे को दे दो, मैं एक्चुअल काम कर लूंगा.
वो नहीं देंगे.
और आप फोटोग्राफ ले लो, फोटोग्राफ के लिए आप आ जाओ. नो ऑन अ लाइटर साइड आई सेड इट, बट आई थिंक दिस इज द प्रॉब्लम. ये प्रॉब्लम है इस देश में कि हाउ डू वी एक्चुअली गेट द मनी टू द राइट पीपल हु आर ट्राइंग टू डू ग्रेट वर्क and not be in the tick in. Aap the nahi yahan pe, humne bola tick in the box to spirit mein jana chahiye. We have to move from ticking the box to actually doing it in, you know, doing actual good work and not just taking photo ops and quickly take a photo and, you know, do it. I think we need to move. I can tell you with clear this thing, it is moving, needle is moving, like she said, madam said just now, needle is moving. What is being done in this country is moving. We need to have patience. The problem is large. I mean, you have a huge population of 1.2, 1.3 billion people. How many people live below the poverty line? The problem is really large. I can tell you, I can see, because I was in corporate India, I saw the way of corporate governance, which was in the country and where it became after a few years. I have hope that that is, can happen. But it requires more people like you, more people like her, more people like many people in this group, to go and actually do their bit and to create a tsunami of people who will come and join you in your mission. But you must have a purpose. Mera purpose kya? Mereko kya karna hai in bachcho ke saath? You see, the point is, many times we go to do something, we don't even know why we are doing it. If you have a purpose ki mereko ye karna hai, aur aap jaake corporate ke saamne jaoge aur bologe, I'm a small NGO, I can tell you many corporates will be touched by you. And if you can go and give real examples of what you have done with your children, there is nothing better than producing, then doing, taking examples of what. Today, Purkal School has brought this young girl out here to produce. These are from the village. Can you believe it? See the way she stands and talks. And this is the new India. This represents the new India which we are living in. And this is what a true purpose of individuals can do. And why can't we create more Purkals? Why can't we create more such schools in this country which can be spread across? And they compete with the best schools. Let me tell you, these kids go and they compete with the best schools in the country. They win, lose, it's not a problem. But it's what they do actually. And I must appreciate what you're doing and what you've done with your personal life, because you're a personal example. If you stand up and say what you were and what you have become today is a great example. And I think, but we need to spread it. Around the country we need to go spreading this. And that's what she's creating actually, if you ask me. But not in this room. The way it will go on social media, there will be tens of thousands, millions of people who will see it. Hopefully somebody's heart will be touched.
And I
just wanted to add one thing. Yes, absolutely what Mr. Rekhy is saying, that's the idea of creating this platform. And believe you me, there is also, as far as the awards is concerned, ek bahut conscious decision tha ki uske andar hum responsible business ko dale. Responsible business, wo large corporates hain ya listed companies hain, jo ki CSR ke andar apna mukam bana rahi hain. To ye platform aapke liye unke saath network karne ke liye bhi hai. So we have the Hindustan Unilevers of the world and various other large companies who are going to be present within this auditorium post lunch. So you should be here and interact with everyone.
Okay, one and then you. Just because we have got limitation, I'll take your question because I'm just trying to, I'll be before I'm thrown off the stage. Because the next session will be starting, so I'm sorry, sir, but yeah.
Hello, my name is Sanjana. I've heard this, you and others using this term of social media, and I think all of us are aware of the importance of social media these days. And what Dave said raised an important point about people using images and using social media to further their cause. I'd like to know from you, ma'am, as well, how do you see people using social media, both in a good and a bad way? Because as NGOs, we face a very difficult problem as to how much of our information, especially if we work with sensitive information like in your field or with children, how much of the information and images do we actually put out on social media? Because we want to, on one hand, social media can give us a lot of exposure and in a certain sense credibility as well when we go out to approach donors, for example. But on the other hand, if you're dealing with sensitive topics, then there is a certain limitation as to what you can actually put out there. And sometimes, like Dave said, like the best work which you do does not actually look that glamorous or creative when you actually put up the images that you can put up on social media. So a lot of the problem which he is facing, I think, is also like an image problem that's created because of the way we use social media. So I would just like to get your opinion on that.
I didn't get your name.
Dave.
Dave, jo aap baat kar rahe the bachchon ko apni tarah se jo aap padha rahe ho aur abhi Sanjana ne jo bola. Mere hisab se jab aap bachchon ko padha rahe ho and you are giving an input, koi zaruri nahi hai ki har bachcha US jana chahiye. उससे कोई फर्क नहीं पड़ता. यू आर एबल टू ब्रिंग अ चाइल्ड फ्रॉम हियर टू हियर, इट इज गुड इनफ. सम ऑफ देम मे रीच हियर आल्सो, बट इफ 90% लोग आपके इतना भी पहुंच गए हैं, देन यू आर डूइंग द मोस्ट वंडरफुल जॉब. दूसरी चीज, सुपर्णा ने अगर आपके एफर्ट को रिकग्नाइज किया तो इट्स यू आर ऑलरेडी देयर समवेयर, इजंट इट? यू आर ऑलरेडी देयर समवेयर. तो मुझे नहीं लगता कि आपको अपने दिमाग में ये चीज रखनी चाहिए कि ये आपका एक वीक पॉइंट है. और जो संजना आप कह रहे थे ना, बैड एनजीओज, एक्चुअली लेट अस नॉट स्पेंड एनी टाइम एंड एनर्जी on bad NGOs. Let's talk only about the good work. Because jaise hame agar Bombay ki taraf jana hai to hum Bombay ki flights ki timings dekhte hai na. Hum Gorakhpur ke to nahi dekhne lagte. So let us look at the good NGOs and the work that they are doing. And I feel that social media bahut zaruri hai. आज के टाइम में सोशल मीडिया बहुत ज़रूरी है. तो जैसे एक कॉरपोरेट होती है ना, उसके बहुत सारे फंक्शंस होते हैं. ऑपरेशंस एक फंक्शन होता है. ऐसे नॉन प्रॉफिट में भी जो ऑपरेशंस है, जो आप असली काम कर रहे हो फील्ड में, वो एक फंक्शन है देव. उसके साथ आपको अपने अलग फंक्शंस जो हैं उनको भी ग्रेजुअली डेवलप करना पड़ेगा इफ़ यू रियली वॉन्ट टू कम अप. खाली फील्ड वर्क करने से आपको उतना सपोर्ट नहीं मिल पाएगा जितना मिल सकता है, और फिर आप उतना काम नहीं कर पाओगे जितना कर सकते हो. तो आपको अपनी एनर्जीज उसी तरह से डेवलप करनी पड़ेंगी और सपोर्ट मांगना पड़ेगा लोगों से. आपके फ्रेंड्स होंगे एंड आई एम श्योर आपको इस प्लेटफॉर्म से बहुत सारा सपोर्ट मिलेगा. सो लेट अस, तो एक बार भी ये मत सोचिए कि नहीं सोशल मीडिया में जितने लोग देते हैं वो तो बेकार है. नो नो, डोंट थिंक लाइक दिस. सोशल मीडिया इज इम्पॉर्टेंट फ्रैंकली, एंड वी नीड टू, हमें उसके ऊपर एनर्जी स्पेंड करनी है. फंड्स लाना इज इम्पॉर्टेंट, अपने काम को प्रोजेक्ट करना इज इम्पॉर्टेंट, अपने जो आपके ह्यूमन रिसोर्सेज हैं उनको डेवलप करना इज इम्पॉर्टेंट.
गुड,
इट्स ग्रेट. तो आपको वो उस मीडिया को थोड़ा सा और ज्यादा यूटिलाइज बेसिकली.
लास्ट क्वेश्चन.
हाय, अंकिता दिस साइड फ्रॉम मैरिको. आई लुक आफ्टर सस्टेनेबिलिटी एंड सीएसआर देयर. माय क्वेश्चन इज दैट आई वांटेड टू ब्रिंग इन टू वन थिंग इज द कॉर्पोरेट पर्सपेक्टिव हियर रिगार्डिंग वी. आई टोटली रेजोनेट वट एवर वी हैव डिस्कस्ड एंड यू गाइज हैव शेयर्ड अबाउट द सीएसआर एंड व्हाट्स गोइंग ऑन इन द स्पेस. My question is that this is all the problem which we all keep talking about, and but I have realized working in this space from past 6 years that, you know, there are a lot of people in the corporates who wants to associate and actually create an impact. In fact, we are associated with the World Economic Forum and do projects at in Mumbai city. So the point here is that how can we deliver and, you know, communicate to the management and bridge this existing gap between the NGOs who are actually, and I'm talking about the good NGOs only, so NGOs and the corporates, because right now it is exactly to a larger extent it's only the, you know, checklist and not the impact. So if you can spare out and throw some light for a minute on this particular solution part. Thank you.
So I think it requires people who are doing really good work, and maybe Suparna, an idea comes out here that a mentee mentoring program can be put on SABERA, where people who have done, like what today we heard huge words of wisdom from her of how she got about it and how the smaller people who don't have access to this kind of ecosystem can actually get it from yours, where you can connect the mentors and mentees. People can come on the platform. I don't know how we can do it, but I'm just trying to think about it. But the point is, for corporates to change, it has to change at the top guy.
Yes.
The promoter or the CEO or somebody who's an influential position has to truly believe in a cause. Because if you believe in the cause, then it's no more tick in the box.
Yeah, but and that point is also coming from, sorry I'm interrupting you, but like regarding the employee engagement. So corporates always believe that, you know, there are certain set of people, sure, who wants to contribute, but they are lacking the problem and the existing idea that, you know, it is not helping the NGOs in sufficing and fulfilling their agenda and the objective. So NGOs can also reach out to the corporates with certain, you know, collaboratively, yeah, if you can develop something so that, you know, the communication gap and this entire gap for the impact can bridge up.
So two things I think we heard from her by saying, I want to volunteer 1 hour, 2 hours or whatever is not going to work. Yeah. So there needs to be some basic training which has to be given. And whoever is going to volunteer should actually be committed to it. Okay. Because then only they can do. Otherwise, it will be just like a tick in the box, you know, going there. One day I went and spent. So I think it will have to be, like I said in the beginning, the corporates, the NGOs, the givers, everybody, government, all coming together to trying and finding a solution. I don't have a ready-made answer to this, but the only thing is, I think it has to be in a belief. And I just want to answer that lady's point. You know, you have to first win the battle in your mind. You cannot say that I have lost, because the moment you say you have lost, you have lost. And if you can say in your mind, and I just like to end with this one small story. I happened to be driving with Santosh Hegde. I don't know how many of you know him, but Santosh Hegde is possibly one of the most honest men in India. One of the most honest, or maybe the most honest man in India. I had this 2.5 hours drive with him from Ranchi to Jamshedpur, and he told me a story. He's saying, my Lok Ayukt, people know me for the anti-corruption drive I did, but that was not my success. The success what he showed me was on his mobile. He showed me a photograph of a young girl who was celebrating her 11th birthday. When she was 2 years old, she was brought to a government hospital and they refused to treat her until they paid bribe to treat. And those parents from the village didn't have money to pay for it. They managed to reach the Lok Ayukt, that is Santosh Hegde. He got her treated. The parents sent the photograph to say, we are celebrating 11th year and thanks to you, she's alive today. I mean, these are the stories that come out. It's not what people do. It's not the money they make. It's how many lives they touch. And he was remembering that story or many similar stories that he had helped people. He's saying, all the poor people I helped, that is what I learned in my stint as a Lok Ayukt, and not where he got the chief minister actually put into jail. That was not important for him, but this was more important for him. Okay, sir, you can, I will not deny you. हाँ जी सर
ये बिल्कुल 100% सत्य है ये जो कॉर्पोरेट का जो 2% पैसा है
हाँ
उसमें इसको स्पेंड करने के लिए देख रहे बोर्ड की मीटिंग में एक कमेटी होती है उस कमेटी में जो है वो फैसले किए जाते हैं कि किसको पैसा देना है या ये टीम जो इंप्लीमेंट खुद करनी है या एनजीओ से करवानी है इससे वो कैरी करती है उसमें भी काफी डिस्प्यूट है अभी जो है गवर्नमेंट ने कह दिया कि जो प्राइम मिनिस्टर रिलीफ फंड में देने का पैसा वो किसी आधार में माना जाएगा वो गलत चीज है लेकिन इस जैसे आदमी जिनका कोई ऊपर जो पखंड वो करने वाला जो उनको अस्मत नहीं है कोई इसके पीछे ताकत नहीं है लेकिन रियल काम करने वाले हैं तो मेरा सजेशन ये था सबेरा से कि इंडियन इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ कॉर्पोरेट अफेयर जो गुरुद्वारा में है उन्होंने एक वेबसाइट और एक अपना बनाया हुआ है वहां पर अगर ये इसको रिकमेंड करने के लिए रियल काम कर रहे हैं तो वो संस्था को सारों को भेज देंगे और वहां का शब्द
डॉक्टर भास्कर चार्य जी जो थे वहाँ के डीजी वो अभी
जो पहले हेड थे इनके वो आने वाले तो उनको भी सजेशन दे सकते हैं ही कैन डू इट बट एनीवे थैंक यू वेरी मच फॉर योर पेशेंस एंड लिसनिंग टू अस
थैंक यू सो मच फॉर द वंडरफुल स्टोरीज
आई रिक्वेस्ट Ms. Mohini Daljeet Singh to come and hand over a token of appreciation to our esteemed speaker on behalf of SABERA.
Thank you so much, Mr. Rekhy. No, you'll get the thing there. And thank you so much, Ms. Ahluwalia. I think I just needed to pick up the phone with Mr. Rekhy. So every time when I'm getting stuck, like my sounding board, like ye, to acha ye kar lo. I'm very, very grateful. And thank you, Ms. Ahluwalia. Ek phone aapko bhi tha aur finalize ho gaya hamara ye siege. Please, with a loud round of applause, let's acknowledge our winners here. We're in a land of karma, है ना? Indian subcontinent is the land of karma. तो अगर हम उन लोगों को appreciate ना करें जो इस समय stage में है, तो शायद हमें भी कोई appreciate नहीं करेगा. So, all right.
Such a pleasure. Come.